how to make sense of this was my first question. How to even begin?
We kind of had to, in the beginning, establish a new language so that we understand each other a little bit better.
We didn't know exactly what would the role of this design, the design be there, and what kind of collaboration we could do, what would make sense. But it was definitely kind of a opening a door and not knowing what is behind, but just deciding to go there and see and learn.
Sometimes it's difficult to kind of jump outside the box and really look at your research from different angle.
Designers, I think, also very often ask these not only what it means, but why.
Maybe it forces you to think about your research in a slightly different way.
In NEWSILK, we really try to build bridges between different disciplines, and really like interdisciplinary knowledge building was the approach in our research.
It's always good if you have different branches of research area, because usually what happens that you would work a long time on the same job section and then get a relatively narrow point of view. But with collaboration with people who come from really different backgrounds and have different kind of approaches to different kind of problems, then the insights they can give you is very valuable.
So we took in the designers at an extremely early stage of research, when molecules just are being designed. And I think that gave kind of a new perspective how in the future we think that materials are made, so that we actually can design materials from the molecules.
Well, this is a very different case from the, let's say, typical case of when a designer would be involved in this kind of project, to cooperate at the very beginning, in the beginning of the research, in a kind of fundamental research phase. And it's very different because there's no material. We are used to prototyping and trying things and experimenting.
Yeah, understanding other disciplinary knowledge is actually quite challenging, because there's always limitations how deep we really can understand the other disciplines. So in that sense, I do believe that we need this collaboration, so we can really go in certain levels. But then when we really begin to talk about this DNA of new materials, for example, so that's not really easy to reach as a designer. But of course, we can always try to imagine where are these application areas for these new materials, and what kind of attributes are needed in this certain kind of context. So in that sense, I think that we can really help also material scientists to try, when they are developing these attributes in the DNA level.
Now, when we talk really about the collaboration between design and fundamental science, aiming to create something that could be in our everyday use one day. As a designer, to understand how long these processes are, how necessary the fundamental science is for these innovations that we are working with.
So I see that there's a huge potential if you think that, well, in the future, if you can really design material attributes even in DNA level quite from the start, might be that we can really avoid using harmful chemicals, and that of course it's a promise for the future, better sustainable future.
It's amazing to see the wonderful ways how nature is able to work with materials.
One of the strongest materials in nature that we know is spider silk. It's made of protein, and actually we have a hard time making materials which are as good as spider silk.
Spiders have been evolved for hundreds of millions of years, so they have a pretty high mechanism of how they pull these fibers. What fascinates me is that I want to find out like how we can do the same thing as they do.
Silk-like protein is actually a connection of bead-like end units connected by spring-like middle part. In free solution, they take compacted form, but then when one starts pulling up the fiber, and one by one the protein opens up, forming a elongated chain, the end bead units remain there carrying the load and pulling the next fiber up.
The way the spider does the silk is rather complicated. There's a lot of different things happening at the same time, which is very difficult to reproduce sort of in synthetic way.
Biology is hard to use just as you find it. So you have to rebuild the systems so that they fit kind of in a more rational way to build things. First thing we need to do is transfer the DNA information into another organism, like a bacteria. Because they are easy to grow and they can actually make the proteins that we want. So they have the same machinery to be able to build the proteins, and we can scale the production of bacterias growing. So we can put them in a big tank, in a fermenter, and grow thousands of liters of them whenever we want. So we can't put the same exact DNA from the spider into the bacteria. We have to edit it, and we have to edit it for many reasons. One reason is that typically the DNA that is in the spiders, that's too big for us to be able to work with in bacteria. So we have to make a bit shorter, and we can make them different. Actually, in a good way, we can make them different so that they're much easier to make in an industrial setting.
Then what we are trying to understand better is this whole assembly process, how the molecules really interact and become very strong fibers.
When we want to use then, for example, silk proteins in a broader way to make materials, we have to learn more about the chemistry, how they behave as materials and as polymers. So we had polymer chemistry also involved.
The most interesting aspect is, of course, the self-assembly of the proteins to a silk fiber in solution. So this is something that requires very special environment usually. But in these projects already shown that actually you can make this easier so that the environment doesn't need to be that special for one to actually draw fibers out of it. And from polymer chemist's point of view, this is also very interesting.
And then we also use molecular dynamics simulation, so computational methods to understand how these protein molecules behave, to be able then to predict how we should rebuild them, and also to help us understand what is really the mechanism of them coming together, this self-assembly into materials.
From the modeling, one can obtain ideas and what are really the things that matter there in this huge spectrum of variations. The primary unit in the spider silk-like proteins are amino acids in certain sequence.
For each position in the chain, you have 20 different amino acids to choose from. That means that if, for example, if we have silk proteins, that is about maybe 100 amino acids. So that is 20 to the exponent of 100, which is a very big number.
And this is actually the basis of how biological systems work.
And there's so much variation of what it really could be. But it actually could be a protein that's part of your brain, or it's part of something completely different than a silk protein. So the variation then that is possible from in this sequence is builds every protein we know, and all of nature is built from. So it's very versatile, this type of molecule, which is a protein that contains so much information. And then depending on the sequence, it functions in so many different ways. So that's incredible.
When one does a simulation of these proteins, actually one ends up having huge amount of coordinates and positions, velocities for the particles, for the atoms there in the proteins.
The numbers are a three-dimensional map of all the atoms and their locations on this molecule, which I found extraordinary somehow that this very dull looking list of numbers is actually containing so much information about a thing that actually is so tiny that we can't never see it.
I was fascinated by the visual, how these modelings, how they look like, because they remind really about the fabrics, printed fabric or certain kind of a surface design. It's amazing how things can be imagined through that modeling, the ways how they can be shown. And of course, I'm as a designer, I read the visual language, but then to understand also the deep meanings that are expressed through those visualizations. It's one of the most interesting things during this project.
Nature makes beautiful things, so nature makes symmetric things, nature makes things that are periodic. They are examples of the structures that self-assemble in nature. And just because they are self-assembling materials, they reproduce quite a bit of the symmetries that also designers like to use.
Well, it's not only spiders that make materials like spider silk. Silk is a type of material that we find in other organisms as well. For example, in nacre, the hard part of seashells, that's made of a material which is very similar to spider silk. So the adhesive, the glue that keeps the nacre together is very similar to spider silk. When we understand the process of how to design the protease, how to produce them, what their interactions are, how they come together, then there's like an unlimited possibilities of variations and combinations and so on. It will really build a platform for making materials in a new way.